Hello and welcome. We're joined today by Matthew Herbert in the British Library's Sound Archive. Well, this is actually one of the five or six studios they have for documenting everything that passes through here, with the idea of eventually uploading it to their site, which you can check online, and which about 80% of the recordings today are taken from. The site is sounds.bl.uk, so if you like anything on the show today, you can check it out again there, or find some more information on what the library holds. But yeah, today you'll be hearing music, of course, some oral history, some wildlife and environmental sounds, as well with some stuff you could probably struggle to define as to where it actually comes from. We'll be bringing in a few guests from the library itself to tell us a bit more about what they've got, because I'm probably not the best guy to give you that information. I'm sure Matthew would agree that he's not either. So yeah, but let's kick things off whenever you're ready. Okay. What have we got coming up first?
Let's play it in the background. So this is a grandfather clock, and we're just going to start with some noises. All sorts of great noises in the sound archive. And, I think it's an interesting, period for sound actually, because there's this sort of slightly weird coloration between sound and music in the way things have been organised up until now, particularly in the 20th century. So even though it's a sound archive, to me, sound is the sound of a grandfather clock or the sound of a fallow deer, which we're going to play next.
Yeah,
but actually it contains all sorts of music, as you said, music, recordings, ethnographic recordings from India and Africa and the Middle East. And it's quite strange sometimes fitting these things together and seeing how they fit together. And so I'm going to try and find some of these connections, but I'm no expert in this stuff, so I've just been very kindly allowed to have a play with some of the thing with some of their recordings. And so for me it's just about listening, so it's just an hour of listening to things that I haven't heard before and trying to find connections between the two. And there's some strange
and yeah, I think that's one of the most interesting things about stuff like this, and a lot of the stuff the library has, is the story behind why it was recorded. And you've probably got some stories yourself from certain albums you've worked on where that's been a key component of how they've been formulated. But I think one of the most interesting aspects about things like this is that a lot of it is done purely not out of necessity and purely out of people just wanting to collect music or sounds. I've been lucky enough to have a little tour around the archives downstairs as well, and there's some pretty incredible stuff. Certain people's very personal collections of sounds that they've compiled over the years, including stuff like crickets and men screaming and all sorts. It's pretty fascinating. But
I think the other thing that's interesting for me is like what's not recorded. I have a friend involved with the BBC archive, and the BBC never thought to record to archive anything. They never thought anyone would want to hear it again, so they don't have anything really. They have like two or three recordings from the 20s and one or two from the 30s, and that's about it really. And it's not really until about 10, 20 years ago they started to record everything. Before that they made a lot of decisions about what to keep and what to throw away. So it's a really important curatorial process about what's recorded and where. And that's what's interesting as well about part of the archive, is you can really trace a strong sense of the British Empire through it, about whether it be people going out and recording African songs, or whether it be we've got a recording of someone talking about the Empire and about Cecil Rhodes and things. I'm just reading a book about the sort of struggle for independence in Africa, and it's really interesting hearing recordings from that period made by people in positions of power and seeing how they justify it or how they talk about it. And I think for me the biggest excitement about this. Oh, I'm
going to have a clock. Yeah. Time's ticking.
So I'm going to, for the first time in Boiler Room's history, segue seamlessly into a into a deer.
I think this is most definitely the one for firsts, this show.
You should ask Cheryl about this. She said it's a fallow deer. It was an extraordinary noise. I thought it was a pig. I should pause it really well. But one of the most amazing things for me about it is about formats. It's like how the foot. I'm going to turn that. Look, let's put the clock back on. It's about formats, which is some of the old formats that were here, like wax cylinders or some of the really early stuff or some of the early shellacs. You can barely discern music in amongst it, and some of them sound very strange. Like, it really is like you're listening back through some giant tube into the past. Yeah. And that dialogue between what's being recorded and the sounds that the format itself makes gets really abstract. So there's a part in the middle where you'll start to hear the crackle just become so intense and sort of rhythmical. It becomes, it sounds like techno to me.
That's kind of one of the things that struck me, partly because a lot of the formats I hadn't even heard of, and a lot of them have kind of died out entirely. Well, the majority of them died out entirely, but some of them weren't even popular at the time. But the processes in which they go through to salvage a lot of the recordings as well is almost as fascinating as the actual material itself.
Yeah, and of course, the other thing as well, of course, you need a whole load of machines, relevant machines, to be able to play them, and just maintenance. So I know, for example, I've got hundreds of mini discs and DATs and cassette tapes and all sorts of and reel to reels and all sorts of formats, but I don't have all the machines to play them on. So you might have this archive and know where to play it on. And in the sort of digital age, we sort of come across that occasionally where your files aren't compatible, but it just seems so strange that you need to have a physical device to play it on. And so it requires a completely new way of listening, actually. And the first thing that you'll notice, looking back over the hours, there's just no bass. I mean, there's more bass on this grandfather clock than there is on the music. A lot of the music that we'll hear. It's like music, it's like bass hasn't been invented yet.
Yeah, or it's just not so we experience that much in stuff like this that's recorded. Should we move along?
Yeah, sure.
Should we actually get through the
Yeah, let's do it, not just chat. Okay. Feel free to come over and ask me any questions if you want to.
Yeah, we'll do.
Okay. Anyway, back to the fallow deer. That's a noctual bat. Great bit of techno. orchestra back.
So at this point, we just ran through, well, all kinds of animals, really. Mainly ones you'd find flying around, but some bats in there as well. But with this section is mainly going to be bird sounds, and most specifically, bird sounds that have been slowed down. I'd like to introduce at this point Cheryl, who works at the library and has a particular base of knowledge on such a subject. Can you tell us a little bit about why they've been slowed down? What's the reasoning behind it?
Well, we wanted to do a CD based on slowed down birdsong, because a lot of the birdsong we have, it's very fast, it's very complicated, and the human ear can't distinguish all the individual notes that's in that song, like a skylark song or a wren song like we just heard before. Mm-hmm. And so we thought we'd slow it down just to see whether or not we could identify all the different notes.
Yeah.
And so, like with this one, that's not the proper speed, that's like 40% the proper speed. But when you slow it down, you start to uncover all of these different notes, you get all the different rhythms and all the different patterns that you don't get normally when you listen to it. And so it was just a fun project for us, just to slow down birdsong to see what it sounded like. And we'd done all the identification guides before, so we thought, let's do something different.
Yeah.
And so we did that, and it was great. It was really, really good fun.
Is fun the main influence on this, or do scientists use it to differentiate certain bird sounds or notice patterns in their behaviour?
It's just both. Yeah. Like for us, we thought, oh, it'd be great, let's just have a go at doing this. Mm-hmm. But it shows the level of detail within birdsong that we can't pick up, but other birds can. Yeah. And that's how, when trying to choose a mate, the females will listen to the different male's song. And if it's very complicated and very beautiful like that, they'll pick him over another one who might not be so good. So it's just a bit of fun.
Yeah.
But with a scientific point as well.
Sometimes science is fun. That's what we're learning today. So where did the archive of this kind of stuff come from? Was there certain people's collections? How much of it is... Did the library go out and have anyone specifically recording things for them?
Well, it's got a long history. The section was set up in 1969, mainly for scientists and naturalists. mainly in Britain as well, but over the past 40 odd years it's grown and grown and grown, so we have recordists all over the world we have relationships with who donate material to us. That's from scientists to artists to amateur recordists to professionals, all kinds of people, and so we've built up, you know, this most amazing collection of all different kinds of animals, so a lot of birds, fish, mammals, amphibians, insects, habitat recordings, all kinds.
You haven't slowed down any others yet?
No, but I really want to. I could spend my time just doing that. It'd be great.
All right, great. What is this one that we're listening to at the moment?
Oh, you've been minute. It's an adder.
No, not yet.
Oh.
Ah. This is Matthew. One of the first questions he asked when he turned up today was whether this was an actual recording or whether it had been edited or otherwise afterwards, because it doesn't quite sound natural.
No, it's
apparently it's 100%.
Yeah. It's made in 1942 in the field, in the Surrey countryside. And they'd been getting ready to do a broadcast of a nightingale and a nice country scene. And then the engineers could hear this buzz coming along, and they thought, what's that? And then they realised it was a fleet of bombers going across to Germany. And so they had to cut the broadcast, but they carried on recording. And they got, I don't know how many hundred bombers, maybe, going across over the head. You still got the nightingale singing,
yeah.
And it goes overhead, and then it fades away. And it's a really poignant recording, because you've got this nightingale singing, oblivious to what's going on, you know, in the middle of a world war. And these men going across, who knows how many came back, and yet this bird's still singing. So it's a very, very powerful recording.
Yeah. That's just the kind of thing you can find there, I suppose.
Yeah, exactly.
The accidental stuff that's the most interesting and tells the most story.
Yeah.
Matthew was actually saying earlier this was on someone's Desert Island Discs.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's got a fan base.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, great. Should we get back to the music?
Yeah,
let's do it.
dug from Mike Woodburn.
Slowly moved away from nature sounds. The sound just before this was actually some woodworms, but it went pretty nicely with the sounds of what it was, I believe, some deteriorated wax cylinder recordings. The man sat to the right of me right now is Nigel, who works here, who's a little bit of a specialist in these kind of sounds and static and the different formats that they've got here. And is actually responsible for helping to eliminate some of these sounds from music. So this is probably rifling him like crazy. Is that right, Nigel?
Yeah, that's pretty much. what we have, or what we endeavour to do, is to make a high-quality transfer of analogue material in the collection without making any attempt at audio restoration. Who's to say what's a better sound? We try and make sounds more listenable if we're making them accessible on our website or as a CD publication by reducing surface noise, the snap, crackle and pop. But that doesn't mean to say it's a better quality sound, we say it's different. Some people may want to listen to the original. Imagine somebody researching an old opera they're going to be performing. They want to get back to the original sound. They find it more pure, more closer to the original recording. They don't necessarily want to hear what my version of the sound is like. So we have many different versions of the sound at different stages of restoration, if you like. When I'm listening to old recordings, I've trained my ear to listen through that crackle, to listen to the original sound. Sometimes I find the crackle quite beautiful. It's part of the recording, it's part of the document. If we want to remove it, we use algorithms and hardware to do so. Never get rid of it totally, even if we wanted to. But we've got some top-of-the-range stuff from a company called Cedar, which will go a long way to reducing any kind of extraneous noise.
Is that something that's changed an awful lot over the years as well? The time you've been here?
It has, and the algorithms improve all the time. One of the reasons that we digitise our analogue to a fairly high standard, and with a geeky hat on here, we digitise to 96 kHz sampling and 24 bits. And if we're digitising a cylinder, people say, well, that's overkill. You know, you don't need that high sampling rate. One of the reasons that we do it is, as the noise reduction algorithms improve over the years, if we've got a better transfer of the surface noise, we'll have a better chance of reducing or removing that as algorithms improve.
Yeah. fascinating stuff. There's actually quite a few examples of the different formats you work with in the studio to your right. I was wondering if you'd be able to pick one or two that you're particularly interested in telling us about. There's also a webcam just to your right there that you can maybe show people it.
Should I help you out? The webcam.
One just there as well.
Oh, right, okay. Yeah, we've got a huge number of artifacts in the collection, and we have machinery to deal with nearly most of them. Here's one here. This one here is an example of a wire recording. Wire recording is a magnetic recording. I've got one here, which is, if you catch the light on it, it looks a little bit like piano wire. That's holding a magnetic recording, much the same way as a cassette might, or how on tape. Here's a wax cylinder. That's an Edison Amberol record, published probably, I'm guessing here, 1912, 1910. That will last for about 4 minutes. And with a nice cylinder in good condition, nicely transferred, that would sound like a cassette would do today. I tell you what, we've got something very interesting over here. I'm just going to duck out.
It's all very well for Morrison to say that we should give the Russians more than a plot.
What we've got here are some, this is a Dixabelt blank. This was a format that was particularly common up until about 1965, 1966. You can probably see the sort of 60s style of the graphic here. Very famously, this was the format that was used to record the Nelson Mandela trial in South Africa in 1962, 1963, before he was banged up for being a terrorist. And those recordings on this very format were discovered by the South African archives. They couldn't deal with them, sent them over here to the British Library for us to transfer, and that's why the Nelson Mandela Rivonia trial is now publicly accessible. Very interesting format.
I think that's about it for now, unless there's anything else you specifically want to go to?
I can talk all that.
Maybe if there's some examples played later on, we'll get back into it, if you can stay on hand. Until then, Matthew at the minute is just going through some recordings of wax cylinders. So this is what they sound like after about 70 years worth of damage. Not longer.
Ah!
Not that old, 10 years old. My bad. Anyway, we're going to move on to that for some of this. I suppose from a similar sort of time, it's the propaganda from the Iraq War.
Yeah, it's sort of, there's something very interesting about who makes these collections and why they make them and what their function is and also what's worth preserving and what it accidentally tells you about the people curating it or accidentally tells you about the society that it lives in. So for example, in a minute after the Iraq stuff, we'll be going into some African stuff, and we have this recording of someone talking about empire. I think I mentioned it at the beginning of the show, but it's amazing being able to place those two, to be able to place someone talking about empire over a piece of music that was from around the same kind of period, recorded about the same kind of time, and hear the two things sit side by side. It's quite an odd feeling, I have to say. And reading about the sort of atrocities in that were carried out in the colonial times in Africa. Something pretty sort of disturbing about it. So we have some Middle Eastern music, and we also have some 1991 Gulf War propaganda from broadcasting Iraq. So that'll be coming up after this. Indian megamix.
I guess the running theme behind that is the reason it's been preserved and documented is because it's seen as, you know, it's obviously pretty important moments in our history, but also some of it is to do with prestige and people wanting to show off about their empires. And, I guess it all relates to how people see recordings of it. It's got to be important.
Yeah, and it's interesting how that idea has changed now, particularly, I mean, even with the, you know, with the year of the selfie last year or what have you, you know, like how we're using, now that we can record anything, everything suddenly becomes important. I mean, obviously, you know, I have children, and you find yourself recording the tiniest sort of bubble of snot that comes out of their nose, you know, because you don't want to sort of miss it. And they'd be the first kind of generation they'd be the first generation to have absolutely everything recorded and be able to access it in a way that we could never do. So I've even got recording of my son being born, and that was just done on a phone. I mean, of course, we've had videos of that for 20 years or so, but to be able to show your kid everything from the moment they're born to their first step to...
Something that's such a personal experience all of a sudden becomes...
Yeah.
Or risks not being personally bought because it's a documented thing.
Yeah, and, you know, my favourite and most important recording out... one of my most favourite important recordings is of my son pooing into a Coca-Cola cup in a playground when we were potty training him. And there's something about the sort of ritual humiliation of it.
Do you intend on archiving these sound recordings in such an establishment as this?
Well, I think there's real... I think there's real value in that stuff. I mean, one of the projects that I've just been... that I'm involved in for a long time is the Museum of Sound, which I've relaunched this year, although it's a soft relaunch at the moment, just while we try and fill it with interesting noises. But yeah, there's nowhere on the internet to listen at the moment, really. And so that's quite... it's quite an interesting... Let's find the thing. This is the Baghdad stuff. So it's quite... I think it's increasingly going to be an important question about what we archive. So, for example, at the moment, I have, much to my regret, I have a Gmail account, and they make it impossible for you to go back and delete big... You have to do them one by one, like big, because they want you to keep your data going so that they can make more money off of selling you the space for it. And yet the server farms that are required to keep all that data are using increasingly greater and greater resources. Apparently now the emissions for the data companies in America are higher than the airline industry. So you might, you know, I try and cut down my flying to help the environment, or I should sort of cut down filming my son pooing in playgrounds as well. Maybe I can contribute that way.
But it's going to be like we're going to have to start to decide soon what's worth saving again.
Well, what making people realise that as much as digital doesn't seem like a physical thing as such, it still does have an effect and it still has to be housed somewhere, even though it can be at a bigger scale.
Yeah, the weird thing was I did this project, this film called Life in a Day that was made out of YouTube clips, and it turns out that that they keep three copies of everything, and the one that's uploaded isn't actually the raw file, so they keep all the raw files somewhere. And then they obviously have the one that they upload, then they have and they have backups as well. And just think, like, a sort of a small kitten falling downstairs or something like that. Actually, you know, if you look at the emissions of that one clip over a period of 50 years or something like that, it's actually going to be, could end up being quite considerable. But yeah, so I think we're going to have to really begin to. Run out of time. Look, we keep running out of time. Let's have a thunderstorm while we think about that.
Might as well have some point yet.
So I think that we're going to have to decide as we go on what's worth saving and what's not. At the moment, we just can't keep just saving everything. It's like digital photos now. You take so many, and yet the chances of going back and revisiting them are quite small.
Exactly. But then you could say that about some of the recordings here. It might not have seemed so important at the time, but when you go back, they really tell a certain story.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, suddenly someone has only got to, Nigel was talking about Nelson Mandela earlier. Well, you wouldn't, maybe you have a recording of him as a child that you don't know anything about, don't know what it's going to turn into in later life, how important it might be, and that retrospectively might become really important. Absolutely. But it's a question that archives, you know, from the BBC to the British Library to all sorts of places, are sort of thinking more and more about what to save and what not to.
Yeah. It's amazing that
you can't keep everything, you know.
Yeah.
Just in terms of like iTunes, you know, it's one of my favourite statistics about iTunes is that 75% of it has never been downloaded once. So it's just a huge archive of unlistened to music. So it's just a vast depository for.
I'm sure the same is true with like most things like that. I'm sure Spotify's got thousands and thousands.
Yeah, there's a site. Is it called Notify? That's like 4 million songs have been unplayed. So it encourages you to listen to the unplayed ones.
Yeah.
But it's a sort of form of digital waste in a way. And it's interesting listening back to these things that are only like 50, 60 years old and thinking about what they, you know, what they mean to us. You know, what will these things sound like in 400 years or 500 years?
Well, there's also, in terms of that aspect of digital, it'd be hard to believe somewhere like this would exist without the internet, or I'm sure it's sped up the process of how they can come about new archives and put it out there for people. You know, this could have been something that the majority of people would never be able to find out about if it wasn't online, or a portion of it at least.
Yeah. Sure,
even the show probably wouldn't have come about without that.
I think one of my favourite stories is on the radio. My dad, I never even got to hear the sound. My dad was telling me a story about that he heard on radio about potters in Egypt. In ancient Egypt, used to wear jewellery, and the jewels on some of the jewellery acted like wax cylinders or vinyl by etching grooves onto the pots that they were doing and accidentally recording the sounds of ancient Egypt. And so historians and archaeologists were talking about taking these pots and some jewellery and turning them, rotating them, and using the jewellery back to hear back sounds from ancient Egypt. It just seems extraordinary that you could actually hear that sound. I mean, where they got any far, you know, where they got to actually do it in any meaningful way is, I'd almost prefer not to know. Just the idea that you could do that seems to be so extraordinary. It makes you realise how little we've had sound. You know, we've had sound such a small, short period of time, really. We've only had it 100 years in terms of recordings, and yet we've had recorded image since cave paintings. So it's such a new format, you know. We're still very clumsy listeners, I think, in that respect.
Can you tell us a bit about what we've got coming up in the next little section? Are we kind of carrying on the Middle Eastern?
We're winding down the Middle Eastern after there was a thunderstorm. And then I think we'll... look, we can still hear it going in the background. So I think we're going to hear some African music. And then it's all kind of there, really. We might hear a bit of... we've got this great recording of someone doing a vox pop of Miss World competition. And there's this amazing quality between the people talking, of like the person being interviewed doesn't really pauses to think about what their answer is. It's a really strange...
I had a brief listen earlier. I think it's partly him pausing and partly the person being interviewed takes some quite seedy deep breaths before coming back with an answer. We'll play that later on. So let's let this run out and then move into
something else.
That's pretty much the theme of the show.
It is, really, yeah. Maybe we'll finish with some giant toads for you frog lovers out there.
I was hoping we'd get to the giant toads. على طه رسول الله شفيع الخلق بالأرض
أجوك بعني شم Abani ga, abani move, and then 1, 2, 3, 4 years, and then listen.
The name of Sir Robert Williams, the founder of the Tanzanian Tribute Companies, is well known to all of you. He was inspired by the spirit of Cecil Rhodes, and was himself a great pioneer and merchant adventurer. His mantle has fallen upon our shoulders, and we hope to prove ourselves worthy successors in our attempts to fulfill his vision and develop the great enterprises which he started. With us here is Robert's grandson, Mr. Ian Hutchinson. He represents the Scottish branch of the Hutchinson family, whereas the chairman is distinctly Irish. We hope this may prove an effective combination. So much for the past, the present, and our ideas for the future. But there is one impression which I should like to leave with you, and that is the inspiration which we derive from coming among those whose outlook is that of free men and women, both determined and able to preserve their freedom by eternal watchfulness, determined to keep themselves free from the tyranny of the lie that all men are equal. Men are not equal. Desires, aptitudes are never on a par, no more than fingerprints or noses are. It is respect for personality which is the hallmark of true democracy. Our main reasons in coming here were to get nearer to the properties in which we have substantial investments, and to spread our risks by making further investments in Central and South Africa. Incidentally, we estimate that the burden of taxation will be lighter after emigration than it was before. As to the latter, we must see what happens. Ours is a British company, interested in enterprises in adjoining African territory. We come to a British territory. This is a change of domicile, not a change of flag or of allegiance.
Iyawo yo bi enu gbono ara ogun la bi baba lo bi aruru bakin ija be nikan ja fogun gbogbo le mu aka iyawo ogun eran ko le foju dode aka ma ma de o ala ka ma ma de o arusi obe ti u kokoloju ala ka ma ma de o
be aka
Emi o le jeun ni ko mu mi ma di emi lo ada won le ire ni a mo se e ba un padi sa o e
padi sa o
e padi sa o
Have you ever been to a beauty contest?
No.
What would you think if your wife or a girlfriend of yours had ever gone in for one of these?
Well, I'd say good luck to her.
Have you any other thoughts on it at all?
No, not really. No. I think anything which adds a bit of spice to life is a very good thing, I think. Bucks people up in rather a drab world.
On the television, yes.
What did you think of the winner?
Well, I thought the winner was excellent, so far as I can see. I thought the winner was an excellent choice. I was very surprised to see that Miss America was knocked out in the final. But I thought the winner was everything that one could desire in a competitor.
I see. Do you think that this form of dress for this form of competition is the best kind of dress?
Well, I think it's sufficiently revealing. You mean the winner's dress is sufficiently revealing because short of a complete nude, I mean, it is the nearest thing to showing the form. And of course, the face is a very big part of the winner's attributes in the competition.
Have you ever been to a beauty competition yourself?
No, no.
Why not?
It's just one of those things, and these things are amplicated for now, it seems, either in films or in television demonstrations. And the people who would find time to go to competition would probably be in the town in which it was taking place. I doubt if the average man or woman would take a special journey to see a competition.
Would you think, you say that they take this on television now quite a lot, would you say this is a good form of television?
I think it is a good form of television. I think it's refreshing, and I think it offsets the more somber items and the items depicting violence, of course, which is part of our time at the moment. It's a very good offset to that.
What would you think if your wife or a girlfriend of yours had entered for a competition like this?
Well, I should be delighted. I should encourage her to do that, because I think that cultivation of good looks, good bearing, good carriage, and that sort of thing is a thing that's been neglected in the post-war years. And these competitions do help.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks.
As well, yeah.
I didn't see it actually.
Have you seen any photos of it at all?
Yes, I mean, a couple in the papers.
What did you think?
I don't think she's been as good as what she has been in past years.
I see. Do you think this is a good form of television?
I think it's a waste of time actually.
Why?
Well, I could think of better things to put on television. You say, you see enough of glamour in the papers and there's enough glamour books going about anyway. I don't think there's any need to televise it.
I see. Have you ever been to a beauty contest?
Oh yeah, well, I've seen seaside resorts and, you know.
And what did you think of that?
I think it's a bit of a farce, really.
I see. What would you think if your girlfriend went in for a beauty competition?
I don't really know. I don't think I'll let her anyway.
You wouldn't let her?
I don't think so.
Why not?
I don't know, I just don't like, it, any of that.
Well,
So since it's boiler room, I thought I'd finish with some excellent black British dance music. But from 1930 something or the other. So it's part of their collection called Black British Swing Bands, and swing's always associated with American bands, but it's, that's what's great about aspects of the collection, is that you discover parts of British musical heritage that sort of maybe got lost along the way. So this is Cyril Blake and his Jigs Club Band, and his track is called Rhythm Is Our Business.
Rhythm is our business, business our business. Get feeling blood, don't know what to do. Get yourself some rhythm too, boy. Rhythm is our business, business our business. There's a clarinet in this band. Ready, plays the clarinet, boys and girls in this band. If you want to hear Fred Grant swinging on up, come on now, listen to Freddie Rhythm Dog.
Goodbye from Linda. I've enjoyed it very much being with you, and I'd like to come again, and I'm very sorry that it's time for you to go. Goodbye from Carol. I've enjoyed being with you. I've enjoyed singing the songs. Goodbye from Caroline. Goodbye from Elizabeth. Goodbye from Tracy, and I wish you could come again. Goodbye from Marie.
Okay.
Goodbye from Marie.
Oh, that's good.
Goodbye from Yvonne. I've enjoyed being here and singing songs.
Goodbye from Elizabeth. I've enjoyed singing songs with you.
Okay. So goodbye to all of you, and thank you all very, very much.
Bye! Bye.
It's almost time for a goodbye from us, but just before that, I'm going to hand it over to Alex, who's going to tell you a little bit more about where you can find this stuff and find out some more about the library.
Yeah, how do we follow that? Less than cherubic voices. Thank you, Matthew, for that. Brilliant. Yeah. So we've basically just scratched the surface there in an hour or so. We've got some 5 million recordings here, 40 formats that, in theory, all are accessible. Most of the stuff you've heard today is rights cleared material that's on our online site called bl.sounds.uk or sounds.bl.uk. I've forgotten the name exactly.
I've got it written down.
Just Google BL and Sounds, and you'll find upwards of 50,000 recordings of all shapes, sizes, colours, formats, all that. But yeah, the catalogue itself, which represents everything we've got in the collections, that any researcher or interested individual can come down and look on the catalogue online and then order those items to be listened to on site here at the BL. Plus there's some published CDs as well, some of those Slow Down Bird song that Matthew played.
Get the promo in.
Yeah, promo. This is Boiler Room.
Exactly. Well, thanks very much. Thanks to everyone from the library for allowing us to do this. It's amazing to get access to this archives, even just a small portion of it. But thanks to Matthew for that wonderful little playlist. I hope it's inspired some people at home to check out a bit more about the library, and we'll be back soon. Thanks a lot.
Cheers.